Thank you, Professor Turner. Ladies and gentlemen, I personally am not going to identify myself either as a social scientist or as a humanist. Having been engaged in the study of the distortions of communicating for a long time, I refuse to fit myself into some communicable category. I would no more willingly lend myself to the spread of categories than to the spread of a disease. I shall take the risk of appearing before you, so to say, naked, without a label. If one speaks today about communications, one is almost forced into a controversy over the mass media. The media are, of course, neutral. Their content a reflection rather than a perpetrator. Through travel, as well as through the media, channels in communication in much of the world are open as never before. Literacy is widespread. Yet, I venture to say that we are lonelier than ever before, and certainly our common human need for world peace, the highest attainment of human communication between individuals as well as between groups, seems further removed than ever. I shall not talk tonight about the mass media per se, nor about the United States per se, but about the eclipse, if not outright deterioration, of our intellectual and moral heritage, which I believe and fear have accompanied the quantitative growth of communication in modern society. It is my contention that a critical awareness of this disquieting phenomenon, even though I have no solution to offer for the problem it raises, is essential to the preservation or perhaps to the restoration of the dignity and growth of the individual. In this sense of urgency and moral crisis, it seems to me we have learned very little about communication from the social sciences, and I speak as one who has spent several years in communications research. In fact, the discussion of communications in the social sciences, just because it is mainly a discussion of mass media of communication, has seriously jeopardized productive discourse between social scientists and humanists who more and more believe that all we do is to play with the computers. Yet, stereotypes of the humanists to the contrary, there are some of us social scientists who believe that to get at the meaning of communication in our time, we had better turn toward the realm of symbolic expression, that is to say, to the arts above all, and perhaps to religion. The humanists sometimes quite rightly suspect that all the social scientists care about are quantifiable aggregates of people and facts, or rather, people as facts. A temperamental illustration for the humanist's attitude towards the social scientist we owe to W.H. Auden. I quote from his poem, Under Which Liar? Thou shalt not answer questionnaires or quizzes upon world affairs, nor with compliance take any test. Thou shalt not sit with statisticians, nor commit a social science. In prose, the poet is echoed by a worthy professor of English, Michigan, who wrote in the periodical College English several years ago, I quote, "Little did I know, and my colleagues less, the social sciences have these many years been studying the popular arts as mass media of communication. In some vague way, we all had heard of it. But what men of sensibility, reading the words mass media and communication, would attach any meaning to them, he would shudder at the vulgar jargon and turn away. I have since spent many a long hour over sociological monographs, many of them as empty as they are execrably written. If I may say so without reflecting on anyone, and that is my private introduction of myself to you, if I may say so without reflecting on anyone, least of all myself, the study of mass communications does not attract the best minds, unquote. But let us leave the battle of the disciplines aside, and let us agree on more common ground for a critical posture. We may all see eye to eye by sampling the mechanisms with which the operators and practitioners of the mass media willingly or unwillingly, consciously or unconsciously, subordinate the legitimate impulses and motives of individual autonomy to the institutions and symbols of mass society. Communication has been almost completely divested of its human content, a content suggested by the word itself. For true communication entails communion, a sharing of innermost experience. The dehumanization of communication has resulted from its annexation by the media of modern culture, by the newspapers first and the consumers' magazines, as they so properly are called in the trade, and then by radio and television. That this dehumanization should have been brought so near perfection in a society which professes an ultimate commitment to the sanctity and autonomy of the individual is one of the grotesque ironies of history. When an individual appears in the media of communication, he is insidiously separated from his humanity. Mass communication relies upon the ideological sanction of individual autonomy in the very process of exploiting individuality to serve mass culture. Note how in the following advertisement of Young Readers of America, a branch of the Book of the Month Club Incorporated, which I'm going to read, Dr. George Gallup's private achievements, his particularity as an individual, is annulled by being made into an instrument of persuasion. I quote, as Dr. George Gallup, a former psychology professor himself, points out in a recent article in the Ladies' Home Journal, if a child can acquire the habit of book reading, it will be invaluable in helping him to cope successfully with all his later experiences in life, unquote. Now, this passage borrows the halo of mass culture, Ladies' Home Journal, as reflected in addition in public opinion surveys, to make palatable the intake of high culture. In citing Gallup as the authority on the value of cultural pursuits, one scores for the finer things in life the master diagnostician who knows what is in the mind of the public, in my opinion itself a fictional concept, and by implication who knows what is best for it. To identify him, by the way, as a former psychology professor, which he is, and a very good one, assures us that he has a good educational background and a respectable professional career, but invokes at one and the same time the sanctions of the intellectual and of the successful businessman and leader in his branch of industry. Another example. Just a few weeks ago, there came over my desk a circular announcing a new venture called Time Books. This enterprise will serve you with a time reading program. I quote, the cost only $3.95 for each package of three or four books, unquote. And for this monthly charge, you will partake in a planned approach which promises, quote, that though your time may be limited, you will be reading widely and profitably books which are truly timeless in style and significance, unquote. The reliability of the selection of this enterprise is beyond any doubt, quote. This plan draws its strength from the fact that the editors spent thousands of hours of finding the answers to questions that you too must have asked yourself many times. It is part of their job to single out the few books that tower over all others, unquote. If you are afraid, ladies and gentlemen, that you might have to personally to worry about the meaning or quality or importance of these publications, rest assured, to quote, in each case, the editors will write special introductions to underline what is unique in the book, what impact it has had or will have, what place it has earned in literature and contemporary thought, unquote. And in addition, you are also assured of a kind of a religious sanction, at least in the wrappings, because it says, quote, the books will be bound in durable, flexible covers similar to those used for binding fine Bibles and missals. That circular, which must have come out in millions of copies, claims that this letter, it calls itself a letter, is, quote, written only to people whom we know to be thoughtful readers, unquote. The circular is called a letter, the most personalized genre of an individual's communicating in writing, an example within an example for the perversion of communication in a mass communications context. And by the way, the ad now has appeared practically without any reference to the selected few in all the magazines, and I'm sure you will not miss the implications of morality in that. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if I convey to you less the ethos of a judicious scale keeper, to coin a simile for one of the favorite and I think untenable self-images of the social scientist today, if I convey you more the ethos of an impatient diagnostician, if not of doom, at least of crisis, that is consistent with my intent. The social scientists of the last two generations, many of them, have built an iron curtain of moral alibis with the concept of value-free research, a concept void of any logic of history. In an era of increasing positivistic infatuation, from which I certainly do not wish to accept a large share of teachers in humanistic fields who should know better, the inalienable birthright of the intellectual as a critic, trivial as this may sound, must be energetically maintained. Plainly, the communication setup of the modern world has corrupted human communication, and the models of society at large, as conjured up by the media, have penetrated ominously and painfully the private realm of individuals in their most intimate spheres of discourse. Conversation per se has become a waste of time. The coffee house, since Dr. Johnson's time in the early 18th century, the refuge of the most delicate or indelicate personal dialogue, has been observed to be on its way out in Europe, and ironically enters under this name on the American scene, yet as an only slightly veiled version of the lonesome Third Avenue bar rail, home of the homeless isolates who make up a significant part of the populace. To be sure, it would be parochial snobbery on my part to indict the modern lifestyle for the decay of language as a genuine experience, including the downgrading of unplanned conversation as merely a phenomenon of American civilization. Let me cite a respondent in a survey recently made in Japan on listening to the media. Quote, for example, so the young Japanese said, for example, it is night and you are sitting alone at your desk with a textbook open. So you switch on the radio and without seeming to listen, you begin to hear the late, late jazz program. And then the rhythm of the music appropriately puts a part of yourself to sleep and banishes excessive worry and longing. And riding to its pace, as though mounted on a belt conveyor, your studies begin to advance a little as though they were automats, unquote. But memorizing one's homework automaton-like is not cultivating one's memory autonomously. Memory is man's receptacle of living language, and language lived by him and his fellow man through human history. Modern man, however, succumbs to a shrinkage of memory. A friend of mine who teaches English at a leading college in the East told me the other day that even when he wants to give an example of popular culture, say a song or a movie, quite naturally referring to his own experience as a young person, he continually discovers to his amazement that his students don't know what he's talking about. It's forgotten. And need I remind you of what has happened to knowledge about the world tragedy in the 30s and 40s among our young generation, whose arsenal of news seems to be made up of yesterday's, if not today's, newspaper or television show? Not only automobiles or washing machines, but language itself suffers today the fate of planned or at least factual obsolescence. What is remembered or what is forgotten seems to become almost indistinguishable, left to chance without any significance. Since I'm supposed to talk in the context of humanitas, I have, of course, to mention Plato. Now, toward the end of the Platonic dialogue, Phaedrus, Socrates tells the story of the inventor god Thuth, I do not lisp, Thuth, who boasts to Thamos, the king god of Egypt, about his innovations and inventions. They sound almost like an enumeration of the basic features of our modern lifestyle, an obsession with technology as well as organized leisure time. Quote, he it was, Thuth, who invented numbers and arithmetic and geometry and astronomy, also the game of checkers and dice, unquote, laying the groundwork, as it were, for the radiation laboratories and the gambling casinos. What Thuth is most proud of among all his inventions is the invention of the written alphabet. He said to Thamos, the king, quote, this invention will make the Egyptians wiser and will improve their memories, for it is an elixir of memory and wisdom that I have discovered, unquote. The wise king, however, spots in this invention the dismal seeds of rote, repetition, and renunciation of self-reliance. Plato's genius discovers in the achievements of civilization their potential threat to culture. Not the spoken word, but its written coagulation contains a germ for scholarship and the literary arts as well as for the derivative products of mass communications, from newspapers to comic books, from time reader leaflets to billboards, those frozen highwaymen of our time. Thamos throws back at Thuth the concept of the written alphabet as elixir, the Greek word for it is pharmakon, from pharmacology, and instead of accepting it as medication, predicts its potentially deadly powers. Quote, for this invention of the written alphabet will produce forgetfulness in the minds of those who learn to use it, because they will not practice their memory. Their trust in writing produced by external characters which are not part of themselves will discourage the use of their own memory within them. You have invented, he said, an elixir not of memory, but of reminding, and you offer your pupils the appearance of wisdom, not true wisdom, for they will read many things without instruction, and will therefore seem to know many things when they are for the most part ignorant and hard to get along with, since they are not wise, but only appear wise, unquote. And as if Plato had wished to tell us with emphasis that communication, true communication, only exists as shared experience, shared with the own self as well as with the self of others, he applies the technique of the dialogue within the dialogue, Socrates speaking to Phaedrus about Thous and Thamos speaking to each other. This indeed is an emphatic emblem of conversation, turning to each other and striving for the common. This is the emblem of the open heart, the open mind, the very opposite of prejudice and stereotype, which are forever present in mass communications and their precipitations on modern men and his lifestyle of borrowed experience. Memory is a benchmark for human, or better, humanistic behavior, as opposed to the quasi-biological, day-by-day, futile-moment-by-futile-moment existence to which modern man seems to have committed himself. The continuity of scholarship, the timelessness of the symbolic mementos of the arts, the tradition-laden connotations of religions, the faithful and solidaric behavior of an individual, all these are variations on the theme of memory, which I am inclined to equate with communication, truly understood as Plato equated memory with philosophy. All these concepts, and I think Mr. Kenner last week seems to have talking about similar things to judge from the right of which I saw, all these concepts, memory, communication, philosophy, refer to genuine experience. After 2,000 years, John Smith, the Cambridge Platonist, restates in 1660 this Platonic credo, quote, "As an organizing argument, I suggest the need for the scrupulous education of men. There is no easy road, for our words must refer to our experience if we are to know whereof we speak, and they must evoke the experience of our peers if we are to be understood," unquote. While I am tempted to say that the Platonic dialogue embraces the idea of the divine coffee house, I shall say that his insistence on the cultivation of memory as a touchstone of individuality and creative participation in human communication does not by chance appear in a dialogue, in a philosophical work whose essential theme is a philosophy of the beautiful. And thus, I have been helped to welcoming the arts as the true guide to the meaning of communication. Enough, then, of this Jeremiad and lament. The humanistic meaning of communication is not entirely forgotten and interred. I hold with Ezra Pound, who, in spite of his aberrations, retains the stature of a poet and a humanist when he writes, I quote, "As language becomes the most powerful instrument of perfidy, so so language alone can riddle and cut through the meshes. Used to conceal meaning, used to blur meaning, used to produce the complete and utter inferno of the past century, and I would add indefinitely of the present century, against which solely a care for language, for accurate registration by language avails, unquote. A story yet to be written, and to which over the last 10 years or so I have tried to make some contribution, is a social history of the intellectual debate on the style of modern life, and more specifically on the fate and vicissitudes of the standards of culture, taste, and morality under the impact of urbanization and industrialization. This debate comes to a head in the critical analysis of the role and substance of the arts and their degraded counterparts, or to use these vague contemporary terms, on the relationship of high culture and popular culture. At least since Montaigne in the 16th and Pascal in the 17th century, and most articulately in individual works as well as in the magazines of the professional writers in England in the 18th and 19th centuries, but certainly also noticeable in continental Europe, a lively discussion arose around the very same issue which Plato so provocatively put before Western men. What is going to happen to us when the very ego, this precious invention of idealistic philosophy, romantic poetry, and the spirit of capitalist enterprise, becomes increasingly enmeshed in the mechanisms of conformity, the whole network of institutional and psychological controls? It would be a painful misunderstanding of the significance of this widely ramified discourse and debate if we filed it away under the rubric problems of leisure time. The very fact that the concern of 18th and 19th century writers again and again turns toward the social supplies of leisure time, the novels, the theaters, the magazines, the newspapers, the sports, the games, and what have you, means that the worried and troubled intellectuals examine critically that space of life within which man supposedly is free, his free time. While, of course, the supporters of conformity, selling their talents to the highest bidders, are not absent among the intellectuals, the emphasis remains in this debate upon the open wound, the wound of imitation, not the imitation of Christ, but the almost mimetic imitation of what one is supposed to imitate. Whether the discussants consider a solution of the crisis of men and society possible or not, whether improvement of education or return to romanticized forms of an agricultural society or withdrawal to an ivory tower or plainly no exit are the powerless recommendations of the critics, the essential verdict long before Ezra Pound is directed toward the decay of language, the limbo of human communication, a theme as essential for Goethe as for Flaubert, for Wordsworth as for Eliot, for Coleridge as for Nietzsche, or for that matter, for a large list of contributors to the Edinburgh Review as well as other journals of sophisticated opinion. This truly humanistic critique turns against instrumentalist language as means for an end, and advocates the autonomous character of the human word as an end in itself, but as a human end. Language, qua language, must retain the sacred dignity of the human condition. I make this paradoxical statement of a sacred dignity of the human condition with intent. language is indeed ideally the definitive logos. There's nothing else available to us for ultimate expression and true manifestation of the individual than language. In this I hold with Jakob Burckhardt, whom one cannot reproach for being insensible to nonverbal creative artifacts, who once said, quote, "If it were possible to express in words the quintessence, the idea of a work of art, art itself would become superfluous, and all buildings, statues, and pictures could as well have been unbuilt, unsculpted, unpainted," unquote. He, of course, said that ironically. The symbolic language of Judeo-Christian religion has continuously emphasized the non-instrumental essence of language by endowing it with divine origin. Look at Psalm 139, "For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O God, thou knowest it altogether." Or look at Sermon 79 of John Donne. "The Holy Ghost is an eloquent author, a vehement and an abundant author, but yet not luxuriant. He is far from a penurious, but as far from a superfluous style too," unquote. The theme is the same. Man is created in the image of God because it is language which makes him partake in the divine. There's a biblical passage which I like to cite, which conveys, I think, archetypically the humanistic meaning of language. Book Kings, first book, chapter 19, quote, "And behold, God passed by, and the great and strong wind rent the mountains and break in pieces the rocks before God, but God was not in the wind." You know that this is in the context of the prophet Elijah and what appeared to him. "And after the wind, an earthquake, but God was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but God was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice," unquote. Namely, the voice of the Lord. When we talk about communication today, we are inclined to associate the strong wind and the earthquake and the fire of the mass media of communication, manipulation, advertisement, propaganda, and what have you, yet human communication is truly the still small voice. A few minutes ago, I emphasized the paradoxical meaning of the sacred in human language. The instrumentalist concept of language, so frequently practiced in mass communications, but alas, also at home in the scholar's world, conceives of language as a tool, and as such, it must be a perfect technological product. Its ideal would be speed reading, speed writing, the teaching machine, finally, the computer. But these ideals, to turn a theological phrase, are the ideals of the devil, because language, as the expression of the creative individual, must also be the witness of his ever-present incompletion. Mortal as we are, our language must reflect our limitations as well as the ever-present tasks, possibilities, and potentialities before us. This is exactly what is betrayed, or at least denied, in the products of popular culture. When the motion picture is finished, or Reader's Digest is read, or the crooner's songs are heard, there is nothing to be said, or to be seen, or to be heard anymore. Creative imagination has become muted, and Lessing Laocoon will have to hang his head in despair. The patent communications mechanism has as its logical and psychological endpoint the off switch of the projector, of the radio set, and the television box, or the switched off mute grimace of the popular singer. But the true meaning of communication, which is held up by the literary artists and above all by the poets, insists on productive imagination, on ambiguity, even on silence. Today, the communications conscience of men is kept alive by the artist who communicates the very breakdown of communication when, for instance, James Joyce explodes the archaic secrets of word and syntax, or when the dramatists of the theater of the absurd explore the radical gulf between word and meaning. However, I don't have to take recourse to the messages of the avant-garde. The scene is as of old, and the witnesses are available in more familiar places. 150 years ago, Coleridge wrote a letter to his friend Southey, aiming at a harmless act of manipulation. Coleridge requested Southey to write a letter to a magazine which Coleridge edited at that time called The Friend, as he said, in a humorous manner, so that he, Coleridge, would be able to reply and explain his attitude towards style in the same periodical. What Coleridge wanted to achieve by this planted interchange of letters was, quote, in the answer to Southey, to state my own convictions in full of the nature of obscurity, unquote. Needless to say, that obscurity is used by Coleridge in an ironical manner. The intent of Coleridge was to stress the commitment of the true writer, the genuine communicator, to the connotative character, or to speak in aesthetic terms, to the ambiguity of language. This letter of Coleridge of October 20, 1809, is a classic and valid statement on the theme to which my paper addresses itself. These are the letter's inherent main elements: the absence of a responsible cultural elite, which would serve as a guardian and taskmaster of intellectual creativity, the increasing atrophy of intellectual demands made on the reading public at large, and finally, the all-embracing emergence of a one-dimensional, non-connotative, unambiguous, instrumentalist language of efficiency and predigested derivative thought, which, as Plato stated, leaves no room for the unique and idiosyncratic, for productive imagination, and not to forget, for the dissenting voice. Let me quote now some of this letter. Quote, no real information, so Coleridge wrote, no real information can be conveyed, no important errors radically extracted, without demanding an effort of thought on the part of the reader. Without demanding an effort of thought on the part of the reader. But the obstinate and now contemptuous aversion to all energy of thinking is the mother evil, the cause of all the evils in politics, morals, and literature, which it is my object to wage war against. Now, what I wish you to do for me is to write a letter to the friend in a lively style, chiefly urging, in a humorous manner, my Don Quixotism, in expecting that the public will ever pretend to understand my lucubrations, or feel any interest in subjects of such sad and unkempt antiquity, and contrasting my style with the cementless periods of the modern Anglo-Gallican style, which not only are understood beforehand, but being free from all the hooks and eyes of intellectual memory, never oppress the mind by any after recollections, but like civil visitors, stay for a few moments and leave the room quite free and open for the next comers. Something of this kind, I mean, that I may be able to answer it, so as in the answer to state my own convictions at full on the nature of obscurity, unquote. It is, I think, with consummate irony that Coleridge calls his philosophy of communication, if I may use this phrase, an act of Don Quixotism. he hardly could have found a more convincing metaphor to stress the productive ambiguity of artistic symbols than the reference to the noble knight who, for the sake of condemnation of banality and triviality, and for the sake of unshakable commitment to the idea of moral men, artistically manipulates a world of trivial objects and banal persons, very much the archetype and pioneer of the modern absurdists. As if he had to answer the spurious arguments of so many managers in the arid fields of mass entertainment who try to convince themselves and us that they have to follow the cues of the masses, Coleridge clearly indicts the manufacturers of information and entertainment for not demanding an effort of thought on the part of the reader, and thus points a finger at the absence of the responsible cultural elite, an issue as much with us today as it was for Coleridge or Goethe or Stendhal, just to name two of his comrades in arms. I dwell on Coleridge because I wish to reassert that it is predominantly the poet who in our time has remained the committed spokesman for language as the ever-given realm of human fulfillment and the ever-present realm of human frustration, creating higher levels of aspiration and attainment. Earlier I mentioned Ezra Pound and Eliot. Eliot created, I think, definitive lines for what Coleridge meant by demanding an effort of thought on the part of the reader, or for that matter also of the writer himself. Let me read you a few lines from East Coker about trying to learn to use words. Every attempt is a wholly new start and a different kind of failure, because one has only learned to get the better of words for the thing one no longer has to say, or the way in which one is no longer disposed to say it. And so each venture is a new beginning, a raid on the inarticulate, unquote. What comes to the fore in this introspective autobiography of the poet intellectual is the infinite care which man owes to his most specific human endowment. Indeed, it is our inalienable human right and task that we attempt to raid the inarticulate, that vast part of the self where it so often seems the self most truly is, and which is denied altogether by the pat, mechanical, and soporific oversimplifications of mass communications. It is a spiritual dimension of life, the mystery of the very heart of being, that we betray by the hideous impoverishment of the vocabularies and instruments of our thought and feeling implicit in the mass enterprise of mass communications to which we are all parts in measure. Party in some measure. Two thinkers as different as John Stuart Mill and Friedrich Nietzsche have both voiced their sorrows over the style of modern life, aided and abetted by literary mass production, and which seems to leave the public no choice but an almost neurotic gobbling up of an endless stream of sounds and sights of words and words, not to be remembered, think of Plato's warning, not to be translated into productive imagination, think of Coleridge's sad exhortations, and not to be translated into dreams, that stuff of which, as Shakespeare willed, our world is made. In an article, Civilization, which appeared in the London and Westminster Review of April 1836, John Stuart Mill wrote, quote, "The world gorges itself with intellectual food, and in order to swallow the more, bolts it. Nothing is more read slowly or twice over. he who should and would write a book and write it in the proper manner of writing a book now dashes down his first hasty thoughts or what he mistakes for thoughts in a periodical. And the public is in the predicament of an indolent man who cannot bring himself to apply his mind vigorously to his own affairs, and over whom, therefore, not he who spoke most wisely, but he who speaks most frequently obtains the influence." Unquote. And in a similar vein, though in a most different style, Nietzsche wrote about 40 years later in the preface of his book, The Dawn of Day, quote, "I have not been a philologist in vain." He was in his youth a professor of classical language at a Swiss university. "I have not been a philologist in vain. Perhaps I am one yet. That means a teacher of slow reading. I even come to write slowly. At present, it is not only my habit, but even my taste, a perverted taste maybe, to write nothing but what will drive to despair everyone who is in a hurry. Philology is now more desirable than ever before. It is the highest attraction and incitement in an age of work," which he writes in single quotes, "that is to say of haste, of unseemly and immoderate hurry scurry, which is intent upon getting things done at once, even every book, whether old or new. Philology itself perhaps will not get things done so hurriedly. It teaches how to read well, that is to say, slowly, profoundly, attentively, prudently, with inner thoughts, with the mental doors ajar, with delicate fingers and eyes." Unquote. To sum up what has happened in our day and age, communication has vastly become part and parcel of a consumer's culture in which those who produce and those who receive are hardly distinguishable from each other because they are both becoming the serfs of a lifestyle of adjustment, accommodation, and regulation. It is the basic tragedy and paradox of modern civilization, and particularly of our own recent phase, that the sermon of individualism has turned into the practice of conformity, that the ideology of education and persuasion through the spoken and printed word tends to become the reality of insensibility and numbness to meaning, and that the professed belief of the powers that be in all spheres of public life, political, cultural, economic, in the convincing power of the worded message is answered by and large by increasing skepticism, if not outright disbelief in the word itself. As I confessed in the beginning, I don't have any prescriptions to offer and certainly no utopias. But I have, in a mood of humility and gratitude, summoned some of the witnesses who, while rather weak as social powers, yet are with us as the ever-present and strong guardians of true human consciousness, the poets. If earlier in my presentation I have intimated my uneasiness, to say the least, in regard to a good deal of communications research we social scientists have been conducting, I would like in the end to regain at least some of the professional territory I have voluntarily ceded in the beginning. None less than the great John Dewey, philosopher and social scientist as well, in his brilliant essay, Democracy and Education, presented us with a definition of communication which I predict, and prediction is allegedly our business, which I predict will still live on when many of the data and findings of communications research will have collected dust. I quote John Dewey. society not only continues to exist by transmission, by communication. There is more than a verbal tie between the words common, community, and communication. Men live in a community in virtue of the things they have in common, and communication is a way in which they come to possess things in common. To be a recipient of a communication is to have an enlarged experience. One shares in what another has thought and felt, and in so far, meagerly or amply, has his own attitude amplified. Nor is the one who communicates left unaffected, except in dealing with commonplaces and catchphrases, one has to assimilate imaginatively something of another's experience in order to tell him intelligently of one's own experience. All communication, so concludes Dewey and so ends his speech, all communication is like art. Thank you very much.
I think we're all very appreciative to Professor Lowenthal for this delightful excursion in the realm of humanitas and communication. If the communication may be a little more artificial than the unplanned conversation whose downgrading our speaker decries, at least we can allow for questions. And Professor Lowenthal has agreed to answer such questions as he wishes to. Are there people who would like to raise questions? Speaker.
Madam, I have to warn you again that I have no prescriptions. Now, first of all, I think the critic has a legitimate place, and I don't know what to do about it. I would certainly not say that the communications industry is void of good brains. They have excellent brains. I would, however, doubt whether these brains are used to work for the kind of communicating which I think would enrich more our experience. It is not a matter of the brains. It is a matter of the structure and the makeup of our societies and of our value systems, which is implied. And I would even say, so that I not be misunderstood, I would not like to be identified with such a silly stance that I think these are all very bad people in the communication industry, and if there only were marvelous people, then everything would be different. The communications industry is part and parcel of our society at large, and they are not more and not less responsible than all of us in our various fields of endeavor. So this is an analytical exercise in a sector of society, but not a personal indictment. I'm not a judge or a district attorney of a segment of society. Pardon me? Oh, the question of the lady was what could be done so that the communications industry would attract better brains, and I say it is not a lack of brain power which is to be considered in the industry. Yeah. Yes. 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 I don't miss a thing. I don't have a television set, and I never switch on the radio except when driving. I think this is a very interesting question, because this self-reinforcing mechanism is the fear we might miss something. This is the essence of conformity, the fear that one is left behind, that one cannot communicate if one is not briefed and aware of everything. I think if you want to have a personal answer of mine, one just has to have the strength of not participating, and nothing happens to you whatsoever. Absolutely nothing. Yeah. Now, you see, that it's always so difficult for me because I really don't have any prescriptions to offer. Now, if you ask me whether I approve or disapprove the prosecution or persecution of any artifact by any formal agency of society or by any informal groups, I will tell you I disapprove of it wholeheartedly. I believe in free access to all created works, and I think much more damage is created to all of us, a much greater trauma is created by any formal or informal censorship than admitting something in the public domain which might not be to everybody's taste. It is an old story. I noticed that I couldn't talk about that tonight. If you read some of this magazine literature in the 18th and particularly the 19th century, you will find continuously the statement that there is a tremendous increase of delinquency and particularly of juvenile delinquency because of all these stories of violence and passions which the young people read. Now, I hear the same stories from Dr. Wertham and in Senate hearings, and if that were true, then the majority of the population by now, since they all went through a stage of youth, must be made up of criminals. Now, that might be so, but it's most unlikely. I do not cede to any agency in our society the right of any kind of a censorship whatsoever. If you personally ask me whether I consider Henry Miller a significant artist, my answer is yes, indeed, I do. I do. I would say that if you ask, by the way, about shocks, you said jolt. There I would also, since we are now I'm now in the situation of answering questions where I have fool's freedom, I can say whatever I want. So my thought about art is that art should shock. Any work of art should be a shock. Now that should not mean that any work of art should be of the kind of shock in substance which you receive in Henry Miller's works. But the function of the artist is to create symbolically the tension, as it were, between reality as it is and the ought. The artist has a mission of showing and creating the gulf between human reality and human potentiality, between a void and fulfillment. And what I have against the mass media is that they are level off the shock. That this tension is not created. That is why I said it is mute. It doesn't have anything to say. Would I suggest what? You have not asked. Well, I must, no, first, yeah, no, but, yeah, well, I try to guess what you mean when you say pragmatic society. Now, first of all, I must really humbly repeat that I am neither a world reformer nor a genius, and neither a genius could suggest remedies for a society at large. First of all, my opinion is that increasingly, the difference between the European style of civilization and culture and the American style is disappearing. And in many ways, Europe is today more Americanized than America. Secondly, I would say that what I have to suggest is what I do. I have always considered it a legitimate function in the division of intellectual labor to be a naysayer. I am one of the naysayers. I'm a critic. I don't have anything positive to offer. I'm absolutely destructive, negative, critical, a fairly friendly man, but unwilling to contribute anything constructive. But I believe that the maintenance of critical awareness is also an important function. What I do to my children is the same thing that I do to you. I tell them what I think. I have a son who I guess is about your age, who studied engineering. Then he got aware of his father's philosophy. So when he had his master degree in engineering, he studied comparative literature. I think it might be. He's now a Coleridge scholar. No, this is, you cannot reduce it to personal things. But I believe that one just has to say what one thinks. I do that not differently to students and children than I do it to my to a group of adults. I do not know. But I think you see, madam, as you know from my biography, I had something to do with propaganda, and I consider myself not a victim, but a theorist of psychological warfare, so I will not run into that trap. I think that some of my own personal attitude was intimated by what I had to say. You lead the young ones to the works of art, to the great symbolic expressions, in addition to what else they learn in the pragmatic context. That is not negative. As parents, yeah, all right. Yes, ma'am. I didn't say that. The great Swiss, yeah, Jakob Burckhardt, the great, but that is where, may I explain that in a second. Jacob Burckhardt was a very great historian of culture and the arts. He wrote the classical work on the art of the Renaissance and the classical work on the history of Greek culture, and his own field of research and concern were architecture, paintings, and sculpture. And when he made these remarks that if one could say anything, everything in words, what is expressed in the fine arts would not be necessary, he meant that, of course, ironical, but what he wanted to say is that the highest endowment, the highest power of productivity, the most specific thing that only a human being can do is speak language. That's what it's meant to say. No, certainly a poet is an artist. Well, that I would not say. I would not say that a poet paints in words as little as I would say that a painter paints with words. Writes with paint. As a matter of fact, I consider that a very wrong kind of aesthetic. And for those of you in the audience who know about the history of aesthetic, you know that I made a crack by referring to Lessing's Laocoon. No, I think as far as if a poet paints in words, he's not a good poet. Uses his words to express something symbolic which cannot be expressed in any other way. Yeah, well, that is not the whole of poetry. Klangmalerei is one stylistic mean which some poets use and others don't use. But I think any poem in which you can clearly separate form and content is not a great poem. Any kind of a work of art where it becomes meaningful to separate content and form is not a work of art.